I be that young rapping dude, might just trap with you. Coming with the thunder, baby, might just clap it crew. I roll out in the morning light, whip that Harley bike. All black, I'm the party type, and it's on tonight. I just stepped in, no weapons, but my outfit might take the soul. See my presence impressive, got strippers slipping off of poles. I just whip, then I swerve and wish you would. I'm Timmy Turner, turned her to a carnivore. Now she treat me like a burger. I don't know their names, but they all wanna ride. All this energy around me, I feel so alive. This must be the vibe, this must be the vibe. This must be the vibes, cause I feel so alive. I don't know their names, but they all wanna ride. All this energy around me, I feel so alive. This must be the vibe.
Yo, what's up guys? Darkbreaker here, and for today's video we are going to play the newest Yina skin Gymnast, which came out recently with the codex, and we are going to play a new build that I actually saw in the Yina server's best list ladder, and I was like, okay, let's try this build out, it looks interesting. I was already a big fan of the Spear of Longness into Fenrir Rush. Full damage early on, you can see our win rate using this build. I mean, I had a really high win rate anyways already using Yina right now, because I would say Yina is, with Richter, those two are my strongest heroes right now, because I just, usually I like to play them when I feel like tryharding, and if I feel like recording some gameplays, I would play some random stuff. And you can see we are already trading against this Suka super well. He's already low life. And what does it mean? It will be a free... I have no idea why this guy still tries to come in, because we were already 2/3 of our life and he was kind of low life. Even if he has execute, there is no way for him to win. So anyways, let's keep our focus on to the build. The build is Spear of Longness, Fenrir, Frostcape, Muramasa, and then Blade of Eternity. So you will hit 40% cooldown reduction using this build, which is actually pretty solid. What I like to do, like my build that I used before, was Spear of Longness into Omni Arms, and then Knight's Blade or Knight's Blade. After Spear of Longness, and then finish into Fenrir, so complete full damage almost. But this build, you are going for full damage, one-shot, bush trapping build. Spear of Longness, Fenrir. The power... But the issue is, Spear of Longness, yeah. But till you have Fenrir, that's a... I mean, you need 3k gold to get Fenrir, so... There is a downtime between your power spike, because the moment you get Fenrir, oh wow, you're super strong, but till you get Fenrir, you are kind of wasting gold, because you spend each time, you have to get 900 gold to get one longsword, and then you need 3k in total, so there's a delay in your power spike. So that's why I used to go Knight's Blade into Omni, because with the same gold amount, Knight's Blade and Omni, you have more sustain, you have more armor, but at the same time you get the burst damage from Omni much quicker than if you go for Fenrir, because you need 3k gold for Fenrir. So there is a huge downtime between getting to your power spike, and he actually, okay, Krycnok still gets the kill, I guess, from the red buff or something. So it's okay if you're snowballing in this build, but obviously I wouldn't recommend you guys to go this game when you're behind. This build when you're behind, or when you're playing against good people, you can't use this build. This build is a ranked build that you can use when you're snowballing and when you are ahead, and when you like to trap in bushes and want to one-shot the opponent, then yeah, you can use this build, but otherwise I wouldn't necessarily recommend this build. Maybe instead of Fenrir, you go for Frostcape first, just so that you are more tanky and you have more sustain and you can trade better in a 1v1 when you're facing a good player. Because this build relies on the bush trapping and playing against weak opponents, so honestly, if I review this build right now, I would say it's okay. But it's not the best build that you can use for Yina in a ranked game. The build I was using before, I would say it's pretty solid, and the reason I go for heavy damage is because otherwise your passive doesn't do damage anymore. Your passive is kind of weak because of the latest nerf, but more AD means more shield, so getting more AD also gives you more shield, so that's a trade-off that your bush form isn't that strong if you go for a tanky build, but if you go for heavy damage build, then bush trapping still works. And yeah, bush trapping works against weak players, people that just don't have good map awareness and face bushes and get one-shotted. That's when those damage builds shine. But otherwise, go for mixed build. Let's say if I was playing competitive match, I would probably just still go for the tanky build. Maybe, let me think. You have the option Spear of Longinus, Frost Cape, or Frost Cape, Shield of the Lost, or Mail of Pain. So between those three items, this would be your third item. First item, boots, obviously, Spear of Longinus. Then you decide between those three items. Then afterwards, then it's going to be your magic item, Troy, Gaia, depending on the enemy's team composition. You want more magic resistance, you want the shield, you want CDR, you go Troy. You want more HP, more sustain, some extra regeneration, you don't need much magic resistance, you go for Gaia, okay? And then, obviously, you will go for Fenrir or Muramasa. If they're super tanky, Marlock, Arthur, Baldum, whatever, super tanky, competitive, they all build really tanky, you go for Muramasa, okay? And if they're kind of squishy, you want the burst damage, you go for Fenrir. And then last item, you can decide, okay, if I go Fenrir, I can finish with Muramasa. Or if I go Muramasa, I can finish with Fenrir. Or I go for more sustain, for second life. I go for Blade of Eternity and pre-order Desticle. That's obviously the safer choice. But if you are ahead, you want more damage, you want more fun, you go for the build I just told you. Fenrir into Muramasa or Muramasa into Fenrir. If they're building really tanky already, you go for Muramasa early, not into Fenrir right away because it's 3k gold. And if they're just super squishy opponents, you can go for Fenrir first and then decide, okay, late game, it's the time when I need Muramasa for the 40% armor penetration, and that's the point when you want to get it. Because most of the times, at the full late game, people will hit those 40% armor resistance, and then it's the point when you want to have Muramasa, okay? Oh yeah, I was told I can't play solo queue, so I decided, okay, sure, I will upload this Yina gameplay solo queue. I mean, my teammates are good anyways, so it's not like it's a hard solo queue match, because my teammates are actually doing an amazing job. But yeah, I mean, there honestly, for me right now, there is no real point to playing solo queue when I can play with friends. There is no really any benefit that I can see playing solo queue, because I don't have to prove anyone if I'm a good player or not. I played for 2 years competitive. I was at every major Western tournament. Western only tournament, because yeah, Valor Series 1, top 3, Valor Series 2, top 2, Valor Series 3, first place, NPT second place, NPT regular season first place. We lost in the finals to the French team, it's Batman. But yeah, that's what I mean when people talk too much about being solo queue only, a solo queue warrior. What's the benefit of being a solo queue player? I mean, sure, you can say I'm such a more skillful player because I play solo queue only. But I think the best place to show your skill or if you're a good player is to play competitive matches, to play tournaments. There are still tournaments right now going on. Like there are Turkish tournaments, Vietnamese tournaments, or the Hexes tournament. There are still ways for you to show your skill in the game. If you really want to show your skills, it's not about like rank. A ranked match, it's just a ranked match. It doesn't matter. Like what's important is when you are in a team player environment, play competitive, pick and ban phase, global pick and ban phase, actually getting target banned, because most of the times solo queue players, they are one trick ponies, they play one or two heroes maximum. It doesn't mean you're a good player, it means you're good, you can play those two heroes or that hero good. It doesn't mean if you play in a competitive match you get target banned, they just ban your hero that you're spamming. What else can you play then? If you play, I don't know, for solo lane you just play Richter, and the moment you get Richter banned, what do you do then? Or you play Richter on the opponent's pick Omen, then you're in a bad matchup, for example. It's all about matchup, global ban pick, and your hero pool. And that's when I think most of the times that people, they like to think they are so good in solo queue or they're so good in a ranked match. It doesn't really matter. It doesn't really transfer into a competitive match. When you have to play consistently well, not just for one game, you have to play consistently well, you have to know all matchups, you have to have a deep hero pool when you're playing. For example, in Vietnam, you play every week, you're playing global ban pick, best of five. That's a huge difference compared to just a ranked match. Ranked match don't really matter, it's just whatever. You can troll around, you can practice your hero or whatever. And how you play in a ranked match doesn't really translate into a real match, because when I play, you saw, like when I'm streaming, for example, a lot of times I'm streaming solo queue, right? But you see my game, you see how I play in a ranked match solo queue. I'm just playing completely selfish, taking everyone's farm, trying to win 1v9, and obviously I will go for jungle then, because it's the best role to carry alone. So, does it really mean I'm a good player if I play selfish, take everyone's farm and then carry? It's like, the best example for this is Tiamo. For you guys who don't know, Tiamo is a player who got rank 1 two seasons. And I would say in a solo queue environment, where he plays Lindus. Lindus is probably the best example. He proxies the waves, he takes everyone's farm away, he has 10k gold. His teammates have 4k gold, the opponents have maybe 5k gold, and he just hard carries, but everyone else is falling behind. But the moment Tiamo played in a real match, in a pro tournament, he played for SK Gaming with Vex and Poseidon, and he was scrimming against us. That's the moment you realize solo queue player mentality and how you play doesn't translate into a real match. And that's why I think, yeah, just, I mean, I will actually upload a few solo queue match, because I got triggered, people calling me not being able to carry any solo queue games. So I have I shot the screenshot. I played Elandor. I never play Elandor. I still hard carried. I played Fennec 15-1. The recording crashed, but I have another Fennec gameplay mega kill coming up soon as well. And then Kriegnak. Obviously, I don't even play those heroes much. If you consider how many games I have in solo lane, more than, I don't know, on some heroes I have like 800, 700 to 1k games, and on Kriegnak 100 games, Elandor, I don't know, 60 games, Fennec maybe 100 games. Those are heroes that I don't even play, and I can still hard carry on those heroes. So it just depends. I could spam Yina jungle and I would get MVP almost every game. I can guarantee you that one. But it doesn't really prove how good you are as a player, because it's just ranked. But I will be happy. I'll be really happy when the solo queue only Conqueror mode comes out. Like, I was talking to Shoko and he said to me that that it's coming out with AoV 4.0, and then Let's see. If I get solo queue, if I get high rank, then I wonder what those haters will still say, because then they have nothing to rant about, because they can't achieve it on their own, and they can't hate anymore. Then what will they do then? If it's Batman. So that's just my take, my rant. And let's focus on the game. Let's talk about the Yina skin. Actually, the Yina skin is really amazing. What I noticed. Wait, let me drink something. I'm talking too much. Let me drink something real quick. Okay, so what I noticed is that the animation and the smoothness of the flicker combo of Yina is amazing. Like, when you use S1 flicker to dash into the opponents, S1 flicker, S2, switch forms, S2 again. Oh, the smoothness of this skin is amazing. If you saw the intro clips, it's so smooth, it's amazing. Try it out. And in this game, this is the second game, I'm playing duo queue with Random, who actually started to play again. I know a few guys asked me why he wasn't playing anymore. I guess he got... Dude, I need to drink more. My throat is a little bit dry. You see the how smooth was that? How's Tokyo Drift? Yina Tokyo Drift. Woo. The one thing that you should know is also that with Yina's S1, you can use your cursor to change the positions while you're dashing. So you can dash really far if you extend your cursor to that direction. But if you pull your cursor to yourself, then your dash will be shorter. So you can dash forward and dash back with just one dash. Do you? I mean, you dash, but you can jump a little bit backwards if you put your cursor to yourself. I'm not sure if I explained it correctly, but just play around with your cursor and you will notice that you can adjust the jump distance and whether or not you want to jump back a little bit. You can use this trick to actually jump over walls and come back again. It's a really tricky, but you can do it. Like at the mid-river bush wall, you can jump over the wall and come back with just one dash. It's a little trick. Maybe I will show you next time when I do another Yina video. But like I said, you can curve around with your S1 with good index control. That's really important to know. And goodbye, lady. Oh, he actually survived. Okay, charge. And I'm super low, S1. This was actually insane. This was actually insane play. If you just put it 0.5 and look at again how I used my S1, my S2, S1 to kill Butterfly. Just rewatch it. And you will see that I dash back and forth onto him with just one dash. And then I just dash out to proc again, and that's how you can immediately proc your passive. Just a little tip on Yina micromanagement. Watch it in 0.5 seconds and then you will, 0.5 speed, and then you will see what I meant. Anyways, I hope you guys enjoyed this gameplay. I see you next time. You guys already know what you have to do. Leave a like, subscribe, and activate the notification bell. Have an awesome day. I see you next time. Bye-bye.